this, what I pay much attention is to assistance. And if you don't, if you're here, if you're not here for 3 or 4 classes, I'll give you an incomplete. I don't care who it is. So many people, after, when I do the grades, they come to complain to me and I say that you didn't make so many classes, so I cannot give you a grade. I wanted to teach you a principle that is found in Deuteronomy 6. This, we find in that chapter something that the Hebrew people consider maybe one of the most important principles in the relationship with God. And it's called the Sema. They call it the Sema. And it's, you find that in Deuteronomy 6. Will you start reading this?
Yeah, the verse there.
Verse 1-4, please.
Okay.
This. Oh, no, wait a minute. 1-2, let me read it.
Okay. The Shema.
Yeah. Yeah, 1-4.
Okay.
No, excuse me, 1-6.
Okay. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live, by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, O Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, promised you. 6.
Okay.
1 through, you know, I start in verse 1.
Yeah.
Then I'm going to verse 4 now.
Okay.
Verse 4. And it says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength."
Okay. This commandment is, as we just read in chapter, in verse 4, the Jews, the real Jews, you know, the real Hebrew people, they repeat that verse 3 times a day. Mm-hmm. And they keep reminding themselves that the Lord is one. They don't believe in the Trinity, of course. They don't believe in Christ because they, even the Messianic Jews, they don't believe, they believe that Christ is the Messiah, but they don't believe that God, that Christ is God. Yeah, that's the big thing. But I wanted to you to pay attention to what that verse calls for. Let's put a little bit aside the fact that it says, "Oh, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one." Let's put that for a moment aside. But if you follow what is next, it says, "You should love the Lord with what?" Okay, let's stop right there. What does that mean? What do you think that that means?
Well, that means with all your heart. That means that's mind and soul.
Including,
yeah.
Right.
That's what I understand.
Yeah, but okay, I think that's right. So what does that mean with mind and soul?
Well, that means...
Because it's right. What you're saying is right.
Mm-hmm. But what I understand, Pastor, when if I will say that, I will love my Lord with all my heart, that means I am new creation. I know what I'm saying. Because, yeah, it's from the heart, you know. Because I think when you have that new creation in you, you know what is the meaning of that, you know, in general. I mean, anybody can say that, but if you don't have that inside of your heart, as what we were reading in the Bible, I have to love my Lord with all my heart, that means including us in your creation. I mean.
Okay. And then he says, with all your mind.
With all your mind.
What do you think that means, sister?
It means that you have always to put in your mind that it's a reminder that every day, you know, you have to be with him. And then you can tell your children and whoever you know who is with you that, you know, always focus on him in your mind that God is always with you.
Let me ask you, when you get up in the morning, who's going to direct your life? Because, see, now she said, the Lord is demanding there that you love him with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. But we have a big battle, you know. We live here on earth, and God lives in heaven. Although God is here also. We're never going to that. However, we get overwhelmed by the principles of this world. We get overwhelmed by relations with other people. We get, you see the history of these people that were delivered from slavery. They God giving the law and the traveling toward Canaan, and they keep ignoring what the law is demanding from them. Why do you think is that? Because we do the same. We're still doing the same.
Yeah, when the Lord is helping them, but these people are always complaining that their lack of they don't really believe.
So the point that I'm trying to make, because I'm saying we are in Romans 6, okay? I'm going to teach you a principle tonight that the Lord gives a commandment. He expects that you, all of us, obey. However, you see these people for 40 years complaining. And they're now about to go in. And what the book of Deuteronomy is a repetition of the principle, the repetition of the law. But you have to pay attention because it kind of variates a little bit from the Exodus and from the way that the four speeches that Moses tells them in this book is because God knows that they are not listening. Now, there is a principle in the Bible that it says in verse 10, in chapter 10, verse 17 of the book of Romans. And it says, we all know that verse. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing for the word of God. What does that mean, really? Because these people have been hearing the word of God for 40 years, and they haven't developed no faith. They still don't believe that they can go into Canaan. They still believe that they are doing everything according to their own strength. They still don't understand the relationship between them and God. Now, I'm going to say something really simple. They are not going into Canaan. God is putting them there. How do you apply that I just said to today? Because you are not doing anything unless God allows it. I'm talking in the kingdom of God. I'm talking about the principles of the world.
We have problems, and we have a problem that you find it the first time in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah, the prophet says, having ears, they don't hear, but it doesn't say hear. It says they don't listen. The original says they don't listen. Having eyes, they don't see. There is a big difference between hearing and listening. When you go to Mark, the book of Mark, in chapter 4, in verse 23, it's the Lord who says that. The Lord says they have ears because the disciples, he just been talking in parables. And then when they got together with his 12 disciples, they asked him, why do you talk in parables? He says, because they have ears, but they don't hear. And they have eyes, and they don't see. He says, and to you, I'll explain to reveal these things. So what is the problem right there? I just read the principle that is involved that you find in the book of Habakkuk. It says that the righteous should live by faith. So if you don't come to grips with you, and you start listening to the word of God, you will never develop the faith that is needed to allow God to take you where he wants to take you. Because in your own strength, you will never get there. Now, we are talking about Canaan, but we are in the 2014. Where do you want to get?
Pastor, what I can see is like the heart of man is the same. 2,000, 3,000 years ago and right now, the heart of man is we are the same. So, where God wants to take me.
Oh, okay. The question is, where you want to get?
Where are you going to get? I want to get in a relationship with God. Closer. And
you cannot get any closer, son.
I don't know how to answer that.
See, that's a good answer.
I don't know how to answer
okay, that. Okay, that's a good answer. Because see, this is the thing, that many people don't know where they're going. And there is a principle in life that if you don't know where you're going, you never get there.
That's true.
See, you want to say something?
Oh, yeah, I don't know what's coming to my mind. I think, you know, because, you know, sometimes we could not hear, if the Spirit of the Lord is not with us, you know, we could not hear. But if
Wait. Did you say something that is very dangerous to say? God will never leave you. The problem is that we don't acknowledge that he's there.
If we don't have relation with God, and you know, if we will not acknowledge that we have a relationship with Him, it's like we could not hear, because you know our flesh is like something, there's a wall in there. But you know, if you have a relation with Him, and you know, it's easy for you to hear, you know, the word, like see, it's like if you have no price, if you didn't receive Jesus Christ in your heart, it's like the Holy Spirit, you know, is not there, it's still in your flesh. Even though you're gonna follow all the rules, you go to church, you do all of these things, you do everything, but it's still empty, and this Christ is
the Holy Spirit. Let me interrupt you because I know what I'm saying. Now let me say this, please pay attention to what I'm gonna say. This that I'm talking tonight, it is all over the Bible, this principle, because it's one of the most difficult things to accomplish. The Lord says, no Moses, the Lord Jesus says, If you hear my voice, what else? What is that after that?
Do not harden your heart.
Don't harden your heart. Anna, have you heard the voice of the Lord?
Maybe.
Okay, to tell me, I'm over ears. I'm going to listen to your voice.
Not lately, but yes.
What do you think is that?
Why?
Because he talks to you every day if you read the Bible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you say that you heard the voice.
What?
You didn't say, did God talk to you through the Word of God? You say, did you hear the voice of God? It's different.
Have you heard the voice of God? That's the question. How about you, buddy? Not
audibly.
Not audibly, okay. How do you hear the voice?
Oh, yes, every day. Through the reading of the Word,
of course. With the reading of the Word.
Sometimes through these people.
See, this is what I've been trying. I'm so very concerned, not only in the Bible Institute, but in the church in general. We approach this. We approach this like a book. And this is the Word of God. He talks to you through this. You cannot approach this like you are reading a novel. You have to approach that because that's what you have to be very careful as to how you read the Bible. You don't read the Bible like many people. You go in the morning or whenever they feel like it, and they just open it.
Yeah, that's what I did before.
Yeah, no, you read the Bible in order. You read a psalm every day, a chapter of Proverbs every day, a chapter of the Old Testament, and the chapter of the New Testament in order. And when you finish, you start all over again. And then you read the Bible with a notebook next to you. You put the date, because if a verse kind of pop up to you like a, you better stop, write it down, at least the chapter, the name of the book, the chapter, and the verse, and write it and put the date. And then later you go and sit down. We are so much in a hurry to get there, and we don't know where we are going. And there is a principle in the Bible. It says, the people without vision will perish. And we come with our own vision. See, we come with our own vision. I want to tell you the problems that these people have. They see Canaan right there. Like if you go to the street, you see the mountain, the hills over there. That's Canaan. And they don't want to go in. 40 years. And they are refusing to allow God to introduce them. Because the Word of God says 35 times in that verse, in that chapter, the land that God has given you, the land that God is introducing you, they are not going to go by themselves. They're going to go with God, right next to them. God is up front. Since they left Egypt, God is there in the clouds and in the fire. Question. Do you feel that God is with you? No, but listen to me, please. Knowing your emotions, but in your spirit, have you been able to discern what is of the spirit and what is of the emotions? Because if it's emotional, it's flesh. And that's the problem that you find with these people. When you sit down and you start studying, you become interested and all that. But when you sit down and you say, well, what's the problem with these people? Of course, we saw the end of the movie, you see, so we know that God wins. But in our case, have you ever thought about it? Because I sit down with the Lord one day and say, what am I, Lord? Am I in Jericho? Am I in Ai? What am I? Am I on the other side of the Jordan or on this side, Lord? Have I allowed you to walk with me? Or am I still driving my own way? Because, you know, I don't know about you, but sometimes I don't know what to do. I know what I want, which is totally different. What do they want? What do they want? These people. The Hebrew people, what do they want?
Well, you know, they just want the easy life.
No, they want to go back to Egypt. You don't think that's the problem of the church? That's the problem of the church.
You want to go back to the world?
Yeah. In fact,
go back and forth.
In fact, they are there.
They don't know it.
Oh, many of them are there. You talk to people and say, my Lord, please. You know, it's okay when you're talking to a new Christian, that person doesn't quite understand. But sometimes you talk to a 20, 25 years people, and then you throw three or four questions, you know, just not too complicated. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
It's kind of sad. Yeah, I don't get angry no more, you know. I just get sad. Because I'm not in a, see, there are verses in the Bible that it says this, for example, that Abraham moved his tent. What does that mean?
Could you repeat that?
Okay, Abraham had a tent, mm-hmm. but he never had it too long in one place.
Yeah, right.
He keeps moving toward Canaan. In fact, he gets there, mm-hmm. and God prospered him. The only one problem that when you go to chapter 12, in the beginning of his relationship with God, he took his tent to Egypt. Mm-hmm. Because he analyzed, he was very new in the relationship, and he did exactly what these people is doing, trying to do. He went down to Egypt. Yeah. Because, and he said to his wife, you tell to his wife, don't tell him that you're my wife. Yeah. Please, you're in the Bible Institute. have to go to a place that you've never been. You have to really start getting the Bible and not to dissect the Bible like you read one book and you never think of the relationship that that book has with the rest of the Bible. Let me give you, somebody open Romans 12.
Romans
12.
Just
verse 3.
Yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the
wisdom. Listen to that verse. Paul is begging them not to think more highly than what they should do.
Yeah.
Okay. Why do you think that Paul is saying that? What's the problem in the church?
That's what you see. Most of the people, that's how they feel. Especially, I think, Pastor, you know, I'm talking about in general. Okay, I'm not talking about this church.
No. Let's talk about this one.
Oh.
Yeah. Let's not go too far. Let's talk about this one.
I don't want to.
No, that's okay. I promise you that I won't put a finger on you. This will stay here.
It sounds like in Las Vegas.
I'm going to help you because I don't know. I'm going to